All right.
Ok, bueno, a todos muchas gracias por estar viéndonos y escuchándonos, para algunos que nos escuchan en nuestro podcast, una sesión más de charlas al LIN, información del estado del Legal Tech en el mundo, en español, en inglés. En esta sesión comparto esta sección de charla salir con mi amiga y cofundadora Stephanie Santana. Y nada, pues estamos abriendo de nuevo la invitación para todos aquellos que aún no nos siguen en Alil para que compartan con nosotros esta pasión por el estado del Legal Tech. Y en esta oportunidad tenemos unos invitados muy, muy importantes para el estado del Legal Tech. En el mundo vamos a hablar sobre todos los temas de automatización de documentos y en particular hemos invitado a Giles y a Macarena, quienes trabajan para Avoca. Avoca pues es una plataforma líder de automatización, negociación y análisis de documentos que está diseñada para ayudar a los bufetes de abogados, los equipos legales y las empresas a redactar sus documentos, a aprovechar los datos para dar mejores y tomar mejores decisiones. Y algo que me encantó de ellos es que su premisa es que en el estado de la negociación se llegue a un sí mucho más rápido. Y creo que eso es lo que hoy estamos buscando con la incorporación de tecnología en las firmas legales y en los departamentos jurídicos. Para contarles un poquito de ellos, Giles pues lidera toda la estrategia de crecimiento de Avoca y trabaja para grandes firmas de abogados en el mundo para poder diseñar y crear soluciones de automatización a la medida para sus clientes. Anteriormente trabajó como abogado litigante de patentes y tecnología y propiedad intelectual y tiene gran experiencia, digamos, en esta parte, lo que le ha permitido hoy pues ser, digamos, uno de los abogados diferenciadores en el mercado y buscando la eficiencia. Y por supuesto, pues Macarena Valenzuela es la gerente de desarrollo de negocios y quien está abriendo mercado y lidera todo el esfuerzo de Avoca en Latinoamérica y en español, y también trabaja en temas de actividades de marketing y participación con los clientes. Ella es también abogada de la Universidad Católica de Chile y antes de unirse a Avoca, pues trabajó en toda la parte de banca y finanzas en la firma que todos conocemos a nivel latinoamericano como PPU. También ya tiene su LLM y ha decidido abrir mercado para Avoca en Latinoamérica. Entonces, sin más preámbulos, le doy la palabra a Stephanie y escuchemos a estos grandes exponentes.
Gracias, Fabián, por el pase. Muy contenta de estar aquí en esta edición apoyando a Fabián en las charlas Alil. Hoy tenemos, como explicó Fabián, dos invitados muy especiales y muy relevantes para todo lo que es automatización de documentos. Esta charla va a ser conducida en inglés porque ellos son expertos, vienen del Reino Unido. Y Macarena es chilena, obviamente, pero para poder incluir a Giles en toda la conversación y que esto fluya mejor, lo vamos a hacer todo en inglés y van a encontrar los subtítulos en español. Entonces los invito a quedarse con nosotros y vamos a empezar hablando con Macarena. La primera pregunta para ti, Macarena. La pregunta creo que parece obvia, pero como sabes, en Latinoamérica aún estamos un poco atrasados con todo lo que es Legal Tech en general y tecnología para contratos. Pero cuando hablamos de automatización de documentos, ¿nos puedes decir qué debemos entender por esos documentos? Ahora voy a traducir esto en inglés para que pueda Macarena responderme en inglés. This question is obvious, but many people in Latin America are still unfamiliar with legal tech and especially document automation. So could you tell us what is it all about?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly. Well, first of all, thank you for having me. Me and Giles, we're very happy to be joining you today. So about your question, in general, automation means using or leveraging a technology to achieve a certain task or process with little to no human assistance. And in the context of document automation, this would be drafting a document. And specifically in the legal environment, it would be a contract. To put it simply, it's simplifying the manual process of creating a first draft of a document. So you don't need to backspace or delete every square bracketed fields. You only need to answer a questionnaire, and then the document will be populated as desired. This obviously saves a lot of time, but not only that, it also reduces errors and improves the consistency of the documents that you're creating. And also the good thing when you are automating your documents is that you are creating a structured precedent bank of data, which you can then access to. So there are many ways in which you can automate a document. At Avoka, what we do is that we are a no-code platform because you have different approaches. So the good thing and the opportunity of using a no-code approach would be that it's basically more efficient. So a lawyer that has no programming experience can actually automate their own precedents, and they are the ones that know better their contracts. And this reduces a lot all the feedback that you can get when you're hiring someone else to do it. And you can also, you don't need to have that knowledge siloed, but it can be very much scalable in an organization. Just to wrap it up, it's important to say that document automation is not here to replace lawyers, but it's actually here to actually assist them with all these repetitive and manual tasks so that they can devote their time and effort to more important things like debating legal programs, problems, commercial considerations, and providing quality legal advice. So yeah, I don't know if that answers your question.
It does certainly. And what would be the difference? I would just like to go a little in depth with this, because yes, I used to work for also a contract, a document automation company, and as had code. So what would be the main difference that you have when you have a no code platform? Does it mean that a user can personalize the experience, or how is it different from a code system?
Yeah, so you have like these legacy tools that are, because document automation has actually been around since the 80s. It's not a new concept. So you have some legacy tools like some very well-known, like Thomson Reuters, for example, tools like with Contract Express. And for these tools, what you need is you actually need to know how to code a little bit, or some programming or specific language. With tools that are no code like Avoka, it's very simple. We actually run Avoka academies in which we teach people to automate in only like an hour. So it's something that it's very intuitive. We use colors so you cannot get lost. You don't need to add like these squiggly weird brackets. I mean, I'm a lawyer. I sometimes, when I see things that are like new, like I don't know if I see like too much math or whatever, if I see programming, like you kind of automatically block, I think. So the good thing is that this is super easy, super intuitive, but that doesn't mean that it's not powerful. It can be very sophisticated. So we have been automating the precedents from the LMA, which is the Loan Market Association. So you're talking about a very large facility agreements, very complex documents, but it's still very, it's very easy to be trained without having any coding experience. I don't know how to code, for example.
Well, excellent. Thank you for that explanation. And something you said in the first, during the first question, is that this tech won't replace lawyers. And I think that's something that worries many. So this brings me to the second question, which I'll say in Spanish first, Giles, and then I'll repeat it in English. So More than replacing, existe la preocupación de que estos sistemas de automatización de documentos o alguna tecnología que ayuda a los abogados a redactar contratos no es para el beneficio de las futuras generaciones de abogados, porque ellos, al no empezar desde cero un contrato, entonces no tienen la capacidad de aprender como debe ser, ¿no? Como los abogados puros y duros. Entonces, ¿ustedes qué dirían ante esas preocupaciones? Okay. Yes. So the question is, when we talk about document automation, professionals are worried that these will be harmful for the new generation of lawyers because they won't be able to know how to properly draft a contract from scratch. So what would you say about it? Either Macarena or Giles, you can jump in.
Sure, I can also take that one. So I guess that many times automation, so anything, automating anything can invite fear, like job losses, fear of change, and all of these can obviously block adoption. Document automation is no different. There are many things that will make some people have some resistance, I guess, at first. But actually, we argue that automating documents can actually enhance and improve your understanding of a document, because you cannot automate something that you don't fully understand. So for junior lawyers, for example, if they are being involved in this process by adding draft notes, playbooks, workflows, all this knowledge, they can actually go in and see how all this logic was behind a document. And we really think that that is very, very important, and it really teaches you and teaches junior lawyers and younger lawyers a lot about actually the logic that goes behind a contract.
I think the thing I would add to that as well, Stephanie and Fabian, is, you know, also, let's be honest, nobody got into law in order to delete square brackets and to insert party names into contracts. The reason they got into law is to negotiate and to give advice and to engage in critical thinking and actually to do bespoke drafting. So actually, using a document automation tool, Macarena's point around having to understand how the automation works in order to use it is absolutely correct. But actually, it also allows you to skip forward a few stages and to take away some of that menial work, so that actually those junior lawyers can probably manage larger transactions and do more of the real in-depth commercial thinking and bespoke drafting much quicker, rather than choosing which of two alternative confidentiality clauses they should include within an NDA, for instance.
Thank you. So Giles, just to continue what you said, so what are the documents that you think are, or let's say a law firm doesn't have, that are not using any kind of tech for this task, what's the first step? What is the main documents or contracts that they can start using this technology for?
Okay, I mean, great question. And so I will address those with very specific examples. But just before I do, I think it's really important to just flag what the key reasons for adopting automation are. They are to improve consistency and accuracy in drafting and across document suites, so where you have multiple documents involved in a transaction. It's to improve productivity, so effectively speed up the drafting process. To share knowledge between lawyers, to improve the speed of that particular transaction or the overall sort of task, and also just to improve the, you know, I guess, user experience, I suppose, that the customer has in the end. So make it, you know, a more custom, quicker, just generally better. Now, you know, the broad question there is, which contracts would, or types of transactions, sets of contracts would be benefit from those kinds of improvements? Well, the answer is basically all of them. And one of the things historically that's been true is actually where you have code, there is a sunk cost and a real challenge in automating documents, because there's a set of skills that you need, and you have to pay for them, or you have to train people to do that, or you have to hire them. And so essentially, historically, it's the best documents have been those which have a really, really long time that you need to dedicate in order to draft them, and actually that clients will pay a lot of money for you to draft. But actually, the model that we're hoping that more and more people move to, and actually our clients have moved to, is their own lawyers automating documents as part of, you know, not just a precedent bank, for example, for financial transactions or large corporate transactions, but for, you know, smaller tasks, so perhaps HR and IP, real estate transactions, logistics and supply chains, and in pharmaceuticals, and, you know, software agreements. You get the general idea. So if you can do it yourself, and you can, you know, perhaps draft an agreement and then the same day automate that agreement, it just makes the catchment, or the, I guess, group of documents that you have that makes sense, and there's a return on investment for you to automate, that much larger. I guess, in addition, there's a sort of other question around what specific parts of a document should we be looking at in terms of when we want to automate it. We should be looking at documents which have a large amount of boilerplate within them. So they've got a lot of the parts of the document that don't change, but they've got a few very clear standard options when it comes to particular provisions. So I use the example of a confidentiality definition. Generally speaking, you're looking at three, aren't you? You're looking at, counterparty owes you a duty, you owe a duty, and then it's mutual. That's a great, great example for automation. And typically people won't want to negotiate that. They're just going to want one of those standard clauses. And generally there's a lot of consensus around those. Also, documents which form part of a family or a batch of documents are really great as well. So for example, loan agreements, but with, which are paired with corporate authorizations and, security agreements and guarantees. And actually one of the great benefits of automation is where you do a batch like that is, you have all your information in the main loan agreement. And if anyone's ever sort of negotiated or drafted a batch of documents, they know that probably most of the information is contained within one agreement. So being able to have that flow through different documents and only enter that data once is a huge benefit. But yeah, I'm going to, give you a few examples from different areas. So in media, one of the key ones that we see a lot of is content acquisition agreements and content licenses. In software, it's software level agreements and, statements of work and distribution agreements. Law firms, the key ones historically have been facility agreements, share purchase agreements, so, acquisition agreements, employment agreements, legal opinions. In the finance area, it's again, loan agreements, security agreements, and corporate authorities. In private equity, there's a lot of NDAs and term sheets and intragroup loan agreements. Real estate is lease agreements and variation agreements. And also across the professional services sphere, we see a lot of engagement letters, due diligence forms. And then, pharmaceutical logistics and supply chain, we see a lot of manufacturing agreements and also agreements to do with IP, which is where I practiced before I joined Avoca. So hopefully not too comprehensive, but that just gives you an idea that basically, now where you have these no-code tools, there isn't a huge limit to what you should be automating. And I think the other point I'd just make as well is to those lawyers listening to this, and indeed people who aren't lawyers who are responsible for contract drafting, you don't need to automate a document 100%. And I think that's a real myth around this. So, don't just think about, documents that you can automate 100% like an NDA. You can automate an SPA, absolutely. Get it sort of 99% of the way there. And then that's where you add your value.
Yeah, I agree with you. So you don't spend time repeating the same information over and over again. It just gets done. And then you can focus on those clauses that are highly, highly specific to the deal or to the parties, right? So yeah, I mean, that's a great time saver for sure. So let's say I'm a medium firm, never spend money on any kind of tech. I see your product or I see some document automation tool. What's the first thing I should do to start using such a tool? Like what is actually the first concrete step? Like, do I gather my documents and read it and decide which one, like how what's the first step, because I think that's the case for many of our viewers. They don't know where to start.
I mean, I guess the first thing to establish is what are you trying to achieve? I mean, what are you trying to achieve personally as well as what are you trying to achieve for the organization? So I think setting your objectives and understanding what you're trying to do, not just it's very easy to say, well, I want to automate the document. It's like, well, great. Once you've got that document automated, you can give yourself a nice round of applause. But actually, it doesn't matter. It's all about the benefits that you're trying to achieve. So are you trying to achieve, reduced admin work and improve job satisfaction within the organization? Because if that's the main thing you're trying to achieve, then you shouldn't be looking at financial benefits. You should be looking at employee satisfaction as your metric. Are you looking to simply save time with drafting? In which case you should look at your current drafting times and figure out which documents take the most time and which are most ripe for speeding things up. Are you trying to make maintaining your precedence easier going forward? Is it an absolute pain trying to figure out which documents have certain clauses in and they need to be changed? And do you have to do that in every single separate template where, for example, you change, again, I'm going to use the confidentiality clause example again. If you have that in change in one of your precedents, so you're going to have to change that in 50. If that's your objective, well, you need to look at, automating a whole bunch of documents and figuring out which ones have those key repeated clauses. you know, and actually this is a key point to mention as well, is it isn't just law firms who benefit from this. And actually it's relevant for law firms to hear this as well. So is one of the objectives to enable self-service of contracts by businesses. Now, that won't be the true for, you know, large scale loan agreements or share purchase agreements for, you know, what, you know, very, very significant transactions. But for example, for an NDA, a confidentiality agreement, the objective might be for the business users to be able to take that without legal doing it, because frankly, it's a waste of time and they're not legal, aren't really adding any value. If that's true, you need to think about which agreements would be suitable for people to access themselves without working with lawyers. And then the other thing as well is, you know, is your objective to, you know, demonstrate a commitment to innovation and just to show your expertise in innovation? In which case, maybe you should think about agreements that are most going to be most useful to people in the world at large. And then maybe you can make those available on your website and allow people to automate those documents and take them away as a PR exercise. And there's nothing wrong with that at all. Adding value to the community is a great way to get clients in. So I think those are all the first considerations I'd make before I start thinking about, you know, stuff like, you know, which of my current drafting tasks and agreements are really repetitive and take a long time. You know, which of them do we have risk and compliance problems with and would benefit from us having, you know, automation so that people can't deviate from whatever our standard policies are. You know, looking at things like where we're incurring indirect costs, you know, where are we needing to get experts in to help us with drafting, you know, most. So yeah, those are all the different considerations and all the stuff around, you know, which of our precedents sit within families, which of our templates are most complete and most ready for automation and have the best sort of different options in them already and drafting notes. All those other considerations are very much secondary to thinking about what you actually are setting out to achieve, because if you're a champion in your firm of one of these tools, you need to make sure that you can point to what you've achieved and say, look, I achieved those objectives. And it might not, you know, one misconception is it's not always a financial thing, because actually our customers, as you know, our clients as law firms are customers, and we need to think of them that way, and we need to think about their experience.
Interesting. So it's not only a tool that you use internally, but it can also be something a main takeaway is like a way to empower your clients too, and a good PR strategy as well. So that's a different way to see how to use tech, which is, I think, at the end achieves the same goal of making you a leader and, you know, having your clients happy. Interesting. So this has been a great conversation. To finish, I would like to ask the last question, and I forgot to ask the other questions in Spanish. So let me ask this question in Spanish first. Según ustedes, ¿cuál es el futuro de la automatización de documentos y de las herramientas de automatización? Hasta ahora veo que es, bueno, economías de tiempo, tal vez ser más dinámicos, mostrar un cierto leadership en tecnología para la práctica de la firma. Pero ¿hacia dónde, qué tendencias estamos viendo y qué es lo que se viene? So, in English, what do you think is the future of document automation and document automation tools?
Okay, well, I think there's one really key theme that I've seen this year. I'm going to go for two. So the first is that people are getting reevaluating their expectations when it comes to document automation. There's been a lot of hype about machine learning, artificial intelligence, natural language processing, but people are realizing and coming around to the fact that actually, you know what, that is probably not the best way to go about drafting contracts. Actually, contracts are very structured, and we know when a certain clause should be included and when it shouldn't be included. And we don't need to augment that with artificial intelligence. So I think there's a real trend to going for no code, intuitive, simple tools. We're not the only one available in the market, but I have to say us and our competitors are becoming increasingly popular as a result of people just thinking, you know what, as long as we can simply designate those logical structures within our contracts, that's the way we should be doing it. Let's not overcomplicate this. So that's the biggest trend that I've seen. The second thing as well is it's kind of related to that, which is increased productization. Now, there's a lot of ways that that manifests itself, but one key way is projects like ours with the Loan Market Association and Allen & Overy. And as part of the LMA Automate project, which is a joint project between all three of the entities, we are taking their recommended form, you know, loan agreements, which they publish, and other finance agreements, which they publish, and lots of banking practices use, but also banking, you know, companies also use as well. And we're automating those, and then we're licensing them back to banks and law firms. So I think there's going to be a real shift towards productization of contracts. And so people will access them, you know, via an online portal, and then they will add their own bespoke amendments on them. So essentially delivering people automated versions of contracts so that they don't need to do that work themselves, where there are certain contracts that everybody uses. So, you know, ours is just one example, but if the listeners look at the market, there's an increasing proliferation of those kinds of tools. You know, one of our notable competitors has released a package for, you know, M&A documents. You know, one of our other notable ones has done it for derivatives. And it's a great way to get people into document automation without them having to do the upfront work, so that when they sort of get a sense of what their benefits are, they can then do some, you know, some more bespoke stuff for their own documents.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much, Macarena. Something to add?
No, I think that Giles actually said it very, very well. Well, maybe the only other trends that I've noticed, especially here in the UK, is how there has been like a more of standardization and looking for standardization. So, for example, with the one NDA thing that is has been going around, or how to actually standardize certain clauses. And obviously, when you do that, you can leverage a lot from document automation.
Yeah, so just to elaborate on that, actually, I think, you know, there's two standardization is a massive theme. The initiative there that Macarena refers to is called One NDA, and it's one of a number of initiatives out there to basically try and get everybody to agree on one form of a document, just to speed things up, where it's frankly mostly boilerplate and nobody negotiates them anyway. So that's, you know, the One NDA initiative is a fantastic initiative doing that. But actually, increased standardization of, you know, data and data points within documents, the reason that I think we're seeing a huge trend for that is to do with obligation management in contracts. So historically, if you have a paper contract, or even, you know, one that's just a PDF, it's very hard to get the obligation out of that and then action them. And that's a real problem for businesses. And it actually translates to a huge business cost. So what we're seeing is increased standardization of clauses and increasing focus on structured data within contracts, so that that information can be analyzed and also exported, so that those, you know, things like renewals can be managed in a much more efficient way, because you know, missing a renewal date and signing up for a increasing cost year on year cost businesses real money. So that's definitely a trend, Macarena.
Thank you so much. Well, this has been a good conversation, and I think a good intro for those of our listeners who are not familiar with these kind of tools. I will proceed in Spanish and to end this session. So, muchas gracias a todos los que han estado presentes. Yo creo que esto ha sido una charla muy interesante, como automatización de contratos 101. Entonces, muchas gracias y le doy la palabra a Fabián para ya terminar esta charla al día.
Bueno, no, creo que me uno a las palabras de Stephanie. Muchas gracias por acompañarme hoy en la sección de charlas al día. Muchas gracias a Giles y a Macarena por explicarnos un poco qué es la automatización, hacia dónde va la automatización, cuáles deberían ser esos primeros pasos para aquellas compañías corporativas o firmas de abogados que quieran iniciar sus proyectos de automatización de documentos. Y pues nada, muchas gracias a todos por vernos. Los invitamos a que nos sigan en Alil, en nuestro grupo de LinkedIn, y seguimos en contacto y nos veremos en la siguiente sección de charlas al día.